All these things spake Jesus unto the multitude in parables, and without a parable spake he not unto them, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet, saying, I will open my mouth in parables. I will utter things which have been kept secret from the foundation of the world. So those things were kept secret from when? The foundation of the world. So they are parables. That is why they are mysteries. Now observe, that scripture Jesus quoted in Matthew 13, he quoted it from Psalm 78 verse 2. I will open my mouth in a parable. I will utter dark sayings of old. Dark sayings is what the psalmist called a riddle in Hebrew. A riddle, which you have to know to unlock. You have to know a riddle to unlock it. Because a riddle is supposed to be a communication, a figure of speech. So the first step to a mystery is not to believe it. The first step to a mystery is to first of all know it. You can't believe what you don't know. You have to see what it's saying first. That's the essence of what Jesus was saying there. They have to know first. They have to know. Seeing they see not. Hearing they hear not. So they cannot believe it. Because you can't believe what you have not seen. So the first thing about a mystery is to know it, not to believe it. Until you know it, you cannot believe it. Isaac and Abraham. Some people use Abraham's story and they zero it on, give God your Isaac. They call it Isaac offering. So by the time a preacher asks you to give God Isaac two times, how many Isaacs are there? How many times did Abraham give Isaac? So why will a preacher ask for Isaac twice? There's fraud somewhere. Give God your Isaac. After all, Abraham gave God Isaac. And then God said, in blessing, I will bless you. In multiplication, I will multiply you. So if God said he will bless Abraham for giving Isaac, if it was literal, then there should have been many Isaacs. Because what God will multiply is Isaac. You see that? But because it was not a literal communication, it was a mystery that required explanation. But you cannot explain what you don't know. So the first thing with a mystery is to know it. Because if you don't know it, you will twist the Bible and teach error very confidently. You cannot ask for Isaac offering, but the audience that is in ignorance will believe it and act on it and bring Isaac. Are they acting in error? Yes. Why? Because the scenario that is used to ask them to give is a mystery. A mystery that should have been explained, but it is communicated literal. So they arrive at an erroneous conclusion. Because if you believe in a mystery, you will end up in an error. If you take a mystery and you make it a practice, you will end up in an error. Because the first thing about a mystery is that you first of all have to unlock it. You have to unlock a mystery to arrive at the explanation. You remember we spoke about the parables of Jesus. For example, 10 virgins, 5 were wise and 5 were foolish. So if you think that parable is about the rapture, and the virgin is talking about, you know, sanctification and holiness, and the bridegroom is Jesus, you know, something is wrong. Because that's not what he meant at all. It was a parable. Meaning, it was not literal. It required explanation. Something is wrong. Or, you've been told that you need oil in your lamp. Give me oil in my lamp. Keep me burning. Get born again. Get born again. Give me oil in my lamp, I pray. They took a parable of Jesus and made a song out of it for believers. Meanwhile, the parable was not to believers. Give me oil in my lamp, keep me burning, get born again. Because the day you got born again, oil came on your inside, the Spirit of God. So if you are still singing for God to give you oil, you need to receive Christ. Or you have received Christ, but you're suffering from ignorance. That oil is, you know, some people say, you know, the oil is the Holy Spirit, and the fire that comes from the oil is continued salvation. If the fire go down, you have lost salvation. You have to apply again. You have to receive Christ afresh. That is where the concept of rededicating your life to Christ came from. Where people keep coming up to the altar, and it makes people feel unsettled, because those kind of messages, it gives you an impression that every time you do wrong, God goes out. And every time you do right, God comes in. So you keep repenting. Every time you do a mistake, God leaves you. Then when you say, I'm sorry, Lord, then God comes back. And you can imagine that when God is going, he goes with his luggage, the luggage that he came with. So God is always packing. Then when he's about to arrive his house, you've repented, he will carry the luggage again and come back. Then God must be jobless, because it means he is not resting at all. He is busy jumping in and jumping out, busy coming in and going out. And that's the kind of impression the messages that deny eternal salvation communicate to people. But you know, we live in a time when there are all kinds of messages going around. And I'd like to read this scripture quickly and take care of that side before I proceed. Matthew chapter 24, verse number 24. For there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. So there are false Christs. Mark chapter 13 verse 22. For false Christs and false prophets shall arise, and shall show signs and wonders to seduce, if it were possible, even the elect. Did you observe that when he talks about false Christ, he talks about false prophets? That means the Christ of false prophets. False prophets have their own Christ. Any Christ that didn't finish the job of salvation is a false Christ. Any Christ that needs your works, your good behavior, your conduct to save you is a false Christ. Any Christ that needs your good behavior, that needs your prayer and fasting to save you, is a false Christ. If your heart is occupied by an angry, judgmental, a Christ that kills, a killing Christ, that is a false Christ. If your heart is full of judgmental bitterness, a killing Christ, you're always praying for people to fall and die, to be roasted, your Christ is a false Christ. A Christ that will get angry and cancel your salvation if you don't get holy and you don't get sanctified is a false Christ. A Christ that died for some of your sins, but you have to finish the rest for him by your behavior and conduct, is a false Christ. You know, Jesus is in heaven. He needs strong praise to come down. When praises go up, blessings come down. You have to give a big offering to motivate God to move. To motivate God to move. That God is a false Christ. Any Christ that doesn't love you unconditionally is a false Christ. Any Christ that didn't finish salvation is a false Christ. Any Christ that will hold your sins against you and keep a record of your wrongdoings, all your mistakes, all your faults, he has it in a book where he's recording it against you after you are saved, is a false Christ. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 19. To wit, that God was in Christ. God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and had committed unto us the word of reconciliation. God does not impute sins. Christ took sins so men can receive forgiveness from the finished work of Christ. But a false Christ does not forgive. A false Christ relies on your effort. A false Christ is waiting for you to be good first before he accepts you. Have you heard those preachers who preach, be a good person before you come to God? Be a good person. God does not want bad people. They are preaching a false Christ. A false Christ. Remember, we read scriptures that false Christ will arise. Any Christ that will reject your salvation because you are not baptized with water. Any Christ that makes a requirement for you to receive water baptism before you can make heaven is a false Christ. Is a false Christ. Salvation is faith in your heart. Confess with your mouth, you are saved. But we live in a time when there are false Christs. We live in that time. And that's why people have to be careful. People must know who Christ is and what he has done. Ladies and gentlemen, he did a perfect job. He did a complete job. Oh, hallelujah. Hebrews chapter 10, verse number 12. For this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down on the right hand of God. Verse 14. For by one offering, he had perfected forever them that are sanctified. Whereof? The Holy Ghost also is a witness to us that what Jesus did is complete. That what Jesus did is once and for all. You don't need any additional. The Holy Ghost is a witness to us. For after that, he had said before. He is a witness. So, ladies and gentlemen, we have the witness of the Holy Spirit that we are eternally saved. And that the work that Christ did was a perfect job. Hebrews chapter 2 verse 10. For it became him for whom are all things, and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons unto glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings. Next verse. For both he that sanctifieth and they who are sanctified are all of one. For which cause he is not ashamed to call them brethren. I thought I would hear somebody shout a powerful amen. When the parable is not explained, when the figures of speech are not taken out of the parable, any practice of that parable is error. Because no matter how strong your faith, if you believe in what I have not said, you wouldn't have believed in what I have said. No matter how strong your faith, if you believe in what I have not said, you wouldn't have believed in what I have said. Selah.